Today we are beginning a new series from the book of 2 Timothy, and we will be looking at the first chapter of 2 Timothy, the first chapter of 2 Timothy. And if you have your Bible with you, I want to welcome you to open your Bible and the book of 2 Timothy. If you come from the village like I do, the page number is 990. 990 is the page number of that Bible, of my Bible. I don't know what yours is, but if you come from the mainstream of the village like I do, Fungua 990, and you will find 2 Timothy right there. And I want to encourage us to be on our feet as we read God's word this morning. If you're swiping there, just swipe and find yourself in 2 Timothy. Let's stand in honor of God's word as we read 2 Timothy chapter 1. If you're there, say amen.
Amen.
If you're not yet there, say wait. Please swipe faster. Buy bundles and swipe faster. 2 Timothy chapter 1, and the Bible says, Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus, by the will of God, according to the promise of life that is in Christ Jesus, to Timothy, my dear son, grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father and Christ Jesus our Lord. I thank God, whom I serve as my forefathers did, with a clear conscience, as night and day I constantly remember you in my prayers, recalling your tears. I long to see you, so that I may be filled with joy. I have been reminded of your sincere faith, which first lived in your grandmother Lois and in your mother Eunice, and I am persuaded now lives in you also. For this reason, I remind you to fan into flame the gift of God, which is in you through the laying on of my hands. For God did not give us a spirit of timidity, but a spirit of power, of love, and of self-discipline. So do not be ashamed to testify about our Lord, or ashamed of me, his prisoner, but join with me in suffering for the gospel by the power of God, who has saved us and called us to a holy life, not because of anything we have done, but because of his own purpose and grace. This grace was given us in Christ Jesus before the beginning of time, but it has now been revealed through the appearing of our Savior Christ Jesus, who has destroyed death and has brought life and immortality to light through the gospel. And of this gospel I was appointed a herald and an apostle and a teacher. That is why I am suffering as I am. Yet I am not ashamed, because I know whom I have believed, and I'm convinced that he is able to guard what I have entrusted to him for that day. What you heard from me, keep as the pattern of sound teaching, with faith and love in Christ Jesus. Guard the good deposit that was entrusted to you. Guard it with the help of the Holy Spirit who lives in us. You know that everyone in the province of Asia has deserted me, including Phygellus and Hermogenes. May the Lord show mercy to the house of Onesiphorus, because he often refreshed me and was not ashamed of my chains. On the contrary, when he was in Rome, he searched hard for me until he found me. May the Lord grant that he will find mercy from the Lord on that day. You know very well in how many ways he helped me in Ephesus. May God bless his word.
Amen.
And Father, we thank you this morning. As we delve deep into these scriptures, as we delve deep into the book of 2 Timothy, we ask for your grace, we ask for your anointing, we ask for the unction of the Holy Spirit to be upon us, O God. Even as I speak, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be pleasing in your sight, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may have your seats in the house of God this morning. 2 Timothy is a very interesting book that Paul wrote. And Paul was writing to his dear son, Timothy. He wrote the book of 2 Timothy to him. And he wrote this book to just with a purpose, with the following purpose, that he will give final instructions and encouragement to Timothy. Timothy was a pastor in a church in a place called Ephesus. And therefore, Paul was writing with this purpose in mind, that he would want to give final instructions to his son, the one that he loved. And not only final instructions, but also encouragement also to Timothy, that as he pastors the church in Ephesus, that the church would grow. Paul also wanted to encourage the church in Ephesus, because the church was going through a period of persecution, and they were experiencing hard times under the leadership of the Emperor Nero. Emperor Nero was the one who was ruling at that time. And therefore, as he was ruling, he was really persecuting the church at that point. And therefore, Paul writes not only to Timothy, his son, but he's also writing to the church in Ephesus, and he's telling them not to give up, not to throw in the towel in the midst of the persecution, but to be encouraged and to be strengthened in the Lord. And this is why Paul is writing the book of 2 Timothy. He is writing to bring forth encouragement. And even as we start the second half of this year, 2019, I want to pray that you will be encouraged and strengthened in the Lord. I don't know what has gone over in the first half of this year. There might have been challenges, there might have been mountains that we have faced and we've gone through, but I want to encourage you this morning with the same words that Paul used to encourage his son Timothy, that be strong, be of good cheer, do not fear, for I am with you. Timothy is being encouraged by Paul, and Paul tells him not to fear. And Paul is writing to Timothy because his days are coming to an end. Paul is in a prison. He is in a cold prison. He was not under house arrest. Initially, the first time that Paul was arrested in Rome, he was under house arrest, and you can see that in the book of Acts, chapter 16. But right now, when he's writing the book of 2 Timothy, he is coming to the end of his life, and he definitely knows that he's coming to the end of his life. And therefore, he is speaking the what you would call the last words. These are the last words of the Apostle Paul. He does not write any other book after this. After this book of 2 Timothy, which we also call a prison epistle, he does not write any other book. It is his last instructions. And he speaks with a lot of confidence as he passes on the leadership to Timothy. He is speaking to the next generation of leaders. And I want to challenge us in this church this morning, because most of us who are seated here, we are parents. Some of us are even grandparents. What are we passing on to the next generation? What baton are we passing on to the next generation that is coming after us? Paul is in prison, and Paul does not tell Timothy or Luke, Dr. Luke as you would call him, or the other disciples and followers of Christ, please bring me good food. Here in prison, things are tough. He says, bring me the scriptures. He says, bring me the parchments, so that I have time from morning to night to even look at the scriptures, to look at the Old Testament, to look at the Gospels, because at the point that Paul is writing this scripture, the book of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John had already been written. They are not new. He wants to have time to interact with the scriptures in his last moments on this earth. He wants to interact with scripture. And I want to challenge us that we need to be people who interact and love the scriptures. Paul loves the scriptures even on his deathbed. Paul loves the scriptures even when he is in that prison. It is cold and there are no parties in that prison. As we have been seeing in the news that there is someone who was in remand and they've been having parties and they've been recording. Some of us will get that later. It is well. It is well. But Paul, there is no party. Actually, his followers have actually deserted him. And sometimes you look at yourself as a leader and you see people around you and you feel happy and you get excited. But the test of your leadership, the test of the character of your leadership is when your followers desert you. When they pack up their bags and they say, you keep doing whatever you're doing, as we will go our own way. It is important that we follow the example of Paul. And that's why he can confidently write in another passage that follow me as I follow Christ. Because even on his deathbed, he is still interrogating the scriptures. He is still meditating upon the scriptures. He is still loving the word of God and knowing the word of God. As we look at this book, if we were to summarize the whole book of 2 Timothy, we would summarize it in chapter 2 and verse 15, which says, do your best to present yourself to God as one approved, a worker who does not need to be ashamed, and who correctly handles the word of truth. That's the summary of the whole book of 2 Timothy. That we would be able to handle the word of truth correctly. We will not be ashamed of the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. And Paul brings out various priorities as he writes this book. And he brings out the issue of sound doctrine. He brings out the issue of steadfast faith. He brings out the issue of confident endurance. He brings out the issue of lasting love. Because this is his last book. And he tells Timothy, even in the face of opposition, in the face of persecution, that he should carry out his ministry without fear and without being ashamed. He tells Timothy, be confident. Boldly use the gifts that God has given you, the gifts of preaching, the gift of teaching, the gift of leadership over the Ephesus church, and do it boldly. Do not do it as a coward. Do it without any fear. Because when the Holy Spirit is with us, he gives us that boldness. The Holy Spirit gives us the strength. He gives us the courage to honor him and to be confident in what he has called us to do. It is important for us to note that Timothy was a sickly young man. He was a sickly young man. Some theologians say that he had ulcers, perennial ulcers. And no wonder in 1 Timothy 5:23, a scripture that most of us would know and identify with at some point, says, these people do not know it in language. No wonder that scripture in first, we can read it later. In 1 Timothy 5:23, we can refer to it later. No wonder Paul gives such instructions to Timothy, because he was a sickly man and he needed to be taking care of his health even as he leads the church. But Timothy was not only sickly, he was also timid. He was about 18 years of age when he's leading the church at Ephesus. When he's given the reins of leadership at the church in Ephesus, he was only 18 years old. And there were other older people, there were other people who were learned in the law, in the scriptures. They knew the word of God well. And therefore, he was a bit timid and he was a bit fearful. And Timothy, Paul speaks to Timothy as a father would speak to a son. And he tells him, I know you are fearful. I know you are sickly, but be strong. Do Do not have the spirit of fear, but embrace the spirit of power, the spirit of love, and the spirit of self-discipline. The New King James Version says, the spirit of sound mind. Because, you know, when you're fearful, you do not think in an orderly manner. Your thoughts are in a haphazard way. That's why Paul tells Timothy, be composed as a servant of God. God has allowed you to be the leader of this church in Ephesus at a time like this. And no wonder, also in 1 Timothy chapter 4, he tells Timothy, do not let anyone look down on you because you are young. And the young people in the congregation said,
amen.
The young at heart said,
amen.
I saw the other day that there is a petition that the age of youth will be revised in the whole world. There is a petition right now in the highest court of the world, in the ICC court. There is a petition that has been pushed forward that we revise the age of youth from the internationally recognized 35 to 65. Ladies and gentlemen, everyone in this church is a youth. I don't know how far it will go, but there is that petition that is being pushed forward. So I look at your neighbor and tell them, you are a young person. Amen. There are people who are happy in the house of God. Paul, and when you look at verse 1 of the scripture that we've read, I like the way Paul introduces himself. Very unapologetically, he says, Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus, by the will of God. Paul knows the will of God concerning his life. He knows that he has been called to be an apostle. He is not a self-proclaimed apostle, like we see some of them in our day and time. Paul was called by God, if you remember your scriptures very well, on the road to Damascus in the book of Acts chapter 9. And as he was making his way there, the Lord Jesus met with him and he told him, why are you persecuting my people? And from that time, his name changed from Saul to Paul. And he knows his mandate. He knows the purpose for which he has been created for. And I want to pose the question to you this morning. Do you know the purpose for which God has created you for? Or are you going through life? Are you going through the motions of life for the sake of it? Paul knew very well that he was not called by the church. He was not called by the elders. He was not called by a pastor. He was called by the Lord Jesus Christ himself. He was sure of his calling. What is your calling? What has God called you to do? Has he called you to be a great accountant? Has he called you to be a great lawyer? Has he called you to be a great real estate manager? Has he called you to be a pastor and you're hiding there? You're running away from the call. What has God called you to do? And because Paul is very confident of the calling of God in his life, he can speak with confidence over the life of Timothy. He can tell him, as one who has been called by God, this is the way I want you to walk in. Even after I have gone, long gone, please follow in my footsteps. Paul tells Timothy to be fearless because of the following gifts that God had given Timothy. The first gift that God had given Timothy is that Timothy was blessed with a spiritual mentor. And all of us by now know who that mentor is. Who was that mentor? Do not fear, even if it is called. Who was that mentor? He was Paul. And Paul was such a blessing to the life of Timothy. I like the way in verse 3 he says, I thank God whom I serve as my forefathers did. And day and night I constantly remember you in my prayers. Day and night. Paul was an accomplished minister. He was learned. But day and night he remembered his mentee, Timothy. Timothy had the blessing of having a mentor like Paul. He was a friend. He was a fellow traveler. Timothy was a son in the faith for Paul. And Timothy was also a strong leader. Despite and in spite of his age, he was a strong leader in the church. And no wonder he was leading the church at Ephesus. And Paul says that he constantly and consistently provides a point and a time to pray for his son Timothy. And I just want to pause there and ask this question. How many of us pray for the people that serve in the ministry? Do you pray for your pastors? Do you pray for the missionaries in the mission field? Timothy was being covered by prayer by his father Paul. And Paul would pray for him. And I believe Timothy would also pray for his father Paul. I pray that in this church we will have men and women who will consistently and constantly pray for the ministers of the word of God. That you will stand in the gap, that you will pray, that you will seek the face of God. And you can see the way Paul expresses himself. In verse 4, he says, recalling your tears. He is not an African man. He is very okay with expressing himself and feelings coming out. You know, African men, we are told we need to be strong. Tunahitaji kukaa ngumu. Even when things are tough, be a man. That's what we tell our children, even the ones that are in quest. When you see your young boy crying, you pat them at the back and you tell them, be a man. And you keep wondering, what were they from the word? Go. But Paul has such a deep relationship with his son Timothy that he can even shed tears. They can shed tears together because of the relationship and the connection that they have. For the older people in this congregation, I want to challenge us. Do you have a spiritual mentee? Is there anyone that you're passing on the baton to? It will be sad that all the nice hymns die with you. It will be sad that all the godly heritage dies with you. Are you passing on the values that you learned from the people that went ahead of you? It seems in the church today, there is a bit of a disconnect. The older people we want to be amongst ourselves. The young people sort yourselves out and the Lord, we even said the Lord, Lord, sort them out. Whatever they are, sort them out. But we are not seeing people who are like Paul, who are embracing the younger people. I want to challenge you this day. Serve as a spiritual mentor. Identify a spiritual son, a spiritual daughter, and walk with them through the journey of life. Secondly, Timothy had come from a godly heritage. His mother and his grandmother were believers. Eunice and Lois, they were believers. They had converted. And I want to believe that they were converted in one of the missionary journeys that Paul took. As he went through the various cities, and more particularly the city of Lystra, I believe that's where Eunice and Lois converted and they became born again. And Timothy is coming from such a rich heritage. Some of us have come from very great spiritual heritages, but we are not passing that on to our children. We think it's shallow for our children to pray. We think it's not cool for our children to be seen praying in school, and we tell them, we can pray in the car. And you pray very fast at the parking lot of the school, lest someone sees you as you drop them. But those people are not in this church. Okay. We've seen them in other schools where they're dropping their children. But those people do not come to this church. Some of us are afraid of passing on or even expressing the heritage from which we have come from. Some of us, our great grandparents are the ones that received missionaries. And yet we are just telling our children, no, it's fine. There are many ways to God. You can just move on in life. It's okay. Just continue. You are doing well. So long as you do well in your academics, that is what counts. That's good. But there is a creator in heaven. And God will hold you accountable if you never passed on the godly heritage to your children. It will be a sad thing. And Timothy is coming from such a background. And I pray that you will not hide your light at home. You will allow your light to shine in your family. You will allow your children to know the Lord. You will shine for Christ so that your spouse can know the Lord. You will shine for Christ so that your parents can know the Lord. You will shine for Christ so that your brothers and sisters can know the Lord and they can see the love and the joy of the Lord in your life. Because if they cannot see it, then they will not get saved. If they cannot see what kind of joy that you have, they will not get saved. And God leads us in different paths. All of us, we are running on our own lane, our own race. And God allows us to run our race, to run on our own lane, in our own journey, in our journey of faith. And we cannot impute our journey of faith on our children. We can only mentor them. We can only disciple them. We can only pray for them, train them, instruct them, and model for them. But we cannot say that now this my belief and my faith is coming upon you, now receive it. And we lay hands on them and they receive it. No, we have to do it practically. Amen. Amen, church? We have a big task as parents. We have a big task as spiritual parents that will be able to mentor those that are coming behind us. Thirdly, Timothy had received certain gifts by the laying on of hands. Energetically pray for you and we lay hands on you because we believe in the laying on of hands. And we see in 1 Timothy chapter 4, where Timothy was being ordained, the elders came and they laid hands on him, and the gift of teaching, the gift of preaching, the gift of leadership was imparted on him. And when now in verse 6 and verse 7 of 2 Timothy chapter 1, when Paul is speaking, he's simply saying that now we are confirming the gift that was put in you when we laid hands on you. We are simply confirming that gift. And the gifts that God has given you are to be used to build up the body of Christ. The gifts that God has given you, they are to be used to empower and to nourish and to build the kingdom of God. And God will give us his strength and his grace to be able to use every spiritual gift regardless of the opposition that we face so that we can be effective in his kingdom. When we allow people to intimidate us, when we allow fear to come upon our lives, then we do not serve effectively in the gifts that God has given us. But we need to allow God to use the gifts that he has given us, because in each and every one of us there is a gift or several gifts, and we need to step up onto the plate and we need to step up and to fan into flame the gifts that God has given us and utilize them both in church and even outside the church, that we will utilize the gifts that God has given us in the marketplace. That gift is for you to utilize it. Even here in church, that gift is for you to utilize it. Do not sit on your gift. Fan it into flame and exercise it very well to the glory of God. Number four, Timothy had God's spirit within him. Timothy had God's spirit within him. He had the Holy Spirit within him. And you can see in verse 7, it says, "For God did not give us a spirit of timidity or a spirit of fear, but a spirit of power, a spirit of love, and a spirit of sound mind," or self-discipline. And these are the characteristics of effective Christians. These are the characteristics of effective Christians. A Christian who is walking in power. A Christian who is walking in love. A Christian who is walking in self-discipline. That you can be able to hold on to your horses. That when you go to the mall, you do not get everything because you can. You exercise self-discipline and self-restraint and self-control and ask the Holy Spirit to help you. The Holy Spirit was resident in Timothy. I pray that every member of this church will encounter and experience the Holy Spirit, and that the Holy Spirit will be resident in our hearts and in our lives. And not just on Sundays. That through Monday to Saturday, that we will be walking in the power of the Holy Spirit. That we will not be intimidated. We will not walk in fear. We will walk in boldness. We will walk in courage. Why? Not because we are good, but because the Spirit of God lives within us. The Spirit of God is in us. And the Spirit of God, the Bible says, it is not by power, it is not by might, but it is by the Spirit of God, says the Lord God Almighty. We are able to do exploits, not because of our own power, not because of our own strength, not because of our own might, but because of the working of the Holy Spirit within us. The Holy Spirit gives us the courage and the strength to serve Him wherever we are. He gives us the courage and the strength to represent Him and to represent the kingdom of God. The same way the Spirit of God was in Timothy, I pray that the Spirit of God will be in us. And when the Spirit of God is in us, He rebukes every manner of fear and anxiety and panic. And we are able to stand for God. And we can confidently say that we are fearless. Not because we are strong, but because the Spirit of God is giving us the strength. Amen. Amen, church. Let's look at the reasons why you and I should be fearless. Why you and I should be fearless. The first one is that there is sufficiency of God's grace. There is sufficiency of God's grace. The church in Ephesus was going through a very difficult time. And there was mounting pressure and persecution, especially upon the Christians. And there was a lot of fear amongst the believers. And you can even see when Paul is writing to Timothy, none of the believers want to associate with Timothy or with Paul because they know that that will bring on persecution. And in the midst of all this persecution, Paul is speaking and he tells Timothy that he should not be afraid to be jailed for the sake of the gospel. He should not be afraid to be put in prison or to be persecuted because he is preaching the gospel. And Paul gives Timothy a promise that God will give him strength even when he would suffer. That God would give him strength. Verse 8 to 10 says, "So do not be ashamed to testify about our Lord, or ashamed of me, his prisoner, but join with me in suffering for the gospel by the power of God, who has saved us and called us to a holy life, not because of anything we have done, but because of his own purpose and grace. This grace was given us in Christ Jesus before the beginning of time, but it has now been revealed through the appearing of our Savior Christ Jesus, who has destroyed death and has brought life and immortality to light through the gospel. Paul speaks with a lot of confidence. He says, because of the sufficiency of the grace of God, do not be ashamed of the good news. Do not be ashamed of the gospel. I have met believers sometimes in the mall or on the roadside, and I tell them, praise the Lord, and they tell me, Pastor, I'm fine. Because they are seeing people around them. I tell them again, my brother, praise the Lord. God has been good. And they're like, Pastor, we are fine. We are doing well. We are doing well. There's a certain, sometimes even just carrying your Bible. You kind of sometimes, some people feel weird when they are carrying their Bibles or along the street or in the mall. You're confident in carrying your Bible. People start looking at you and you feel like you need to go into the supermarket, not buy anything, but just buy a bag. And you put the Bible inside there and just walk without feeling any condemnation. And this is what Paul is telling Timothy. Do not be ashamed of the gospel. Some of us in our offices, no one, including your best friend, knows that you're born again. And you comfort yourself and you tell yourself, they will know me by my fruits. You know, that's how we speak as believers. When we are not confident enough to share, we say, they will know me by my fruits. And yet your fruits are not very good. So they are learning the contrary thing other than what they should. No, I challenge us. The same way Paul was challenging Timothy. He was telling Timothy, do not be ashamed of the gospel, even in the midst of persecution. And we thank God that in this nation, we are not facing persecution. But it is very difficult, you will bear witness with me, it's very difficult for you just to start sharing the gospel with a person seated next to you on the airplane. It is much easier to talk about politics, isn't that right? It is much easier to talk about AFCON and who has been eliminated and who is still around. And you do an analysis of every player. But just saying, do you know where you would spend eternity? You start feeling jittery. You feel like at that point is where you need to call the hostess to give you coffee so that you can have more boldness to share. But the scripture is very clear. Let us not be ashamed of the gospel. And I dare you, when you step up, the Holy Spirit will give you the courage. When you step up to share and be bold about the gospel, the Holy Spirit will give you the courage and you will be able to testify of the goodness of God. And I like the way Paul summarizes the whole gospel in this three verses. He gives us the picture of God's love. It talks about that even before time, the grace of God had already been extended. That shows us the magnitude of God's love. And that not only that he even chose us from before time began. God already chose us. And he sent his son, Jesus Christ, to die for us. We do not deserve it. We did not deserve it. But because of the grace of God, which is the unmerited favor of God, we can be called his children. And the best way of responding to the grace of God is to receive the Lord Jesus Christ in our hearts and to embrace him and to accept the offer that he has graciously given to us. The grace of God is sufficient. The grace of God, ladies and gentlemen, is sufficient. Regardless of where you've been, regardless of the manner of life that you have led, the grace of God is sufficient to save you and to make you a new creation. The Bible says that when we come to Christ, we are no longer old, but we become a new creation. The old goes, and we become a new creation. The sufficiency
of God's grace.
Regardless of the sin that you have committed, the grace of God is sufficient to draw you unto Himself. Regardless of the thoughts that you have, the things that you have done, the things that you have spoken, the grace of God is sufficient to call you and to draw you back to Himself. The sufficiency of God's grace. Even before time began, and even after time, as we know it, lapses, the sufficiency of God's grace will continue to be there. Secondly, why should I and you not fear, or why should we be fearless? Because we are cognizant of the privilege given to us. We are cognizant of the privilege given to us. And what is this privilege? This privilege is communicating the gospel, which is the good news. If that was not the case, we would get saved and we would immediately go to heaven. But God has graciously given us the privilege to become co-workers with Him, to become partners with Him in His kingdom, to share the good news. And Paul is such an example to Timothy that he was called by God to personally share the good news, and especially to the Gentile world. He was a herald. He was not only a herald in verse 11, he was also an apostle. An apostle is one who has been sent with a commission. He's one who has been sent with a commission. And not every Christian can be an apostle. There are certain qualifications for one to be an apostle. And you can see those qualifications in Acts 1:15-26, in 1 Corinthians 9:1, in 2 Corinthians 12:12. Therefore, as an apostle, Paul was a representative of the Lord Jesus Christ Himself. And all of us, as children of God, we are representatives of the Lord Jesus Christ. Wherever we are during the week, we are representatives of the Lord Jesus Christ. Paul was also a teacher of the Word of God. He would explain the scriptures to the Gentiles, and his calling was very particular and peculiar, that he knew that he had been called to the Gentiles and not to the Jews. And he went to them and he taught them the Word of God, and he helped them embrace the good news, which is the gospel. And he was not ashamed of this, and he knew that this was a privilege. Ladies and gentlemen, the same way it was a privilege for Paul, for him to be entrusted the Word of God, it is a privilege for us to be entrusted with the Word of God. And it is not just for the pastors, it is also for you who are seated as you listen to me this morning. It is also for you that you will do something with the gospel, that the next door neighbor will know about Christ because you've shared with them, that your colleague at your place of work will know about Jesus Christ because you've shared with them, that your business partner will know about Jesus Christ because you have shared with them. And God will hold you and I accountable. He will hold us accountable. Thirdly, we should be fearless because we are confident of the future. We should be fearless because we are confident of the future. And why is this? Because the future is in the hands of God. It is not in our hands. The future is in the hands of God. And Paul says that God is, he says with a lot of confidence, he says in verse 12, that is why I am suffering as I am. Yet I am not ashamed, because I know whom I have believed, and I am convinced that he is able to guard what I have entrusted to him for that day. God does not turn back on his word. There's a song that we sing, God is able to do all that he said that he will do. He's gonna fulfill every promise that he's given you because he is able. And Paul says, I am convinced. I am persuaded that God is able to guard that which I have entrusted to Him. I have entrusted my life to in the hands of God, and I know that God is able to guard my life against every attack of the enemy. Despite and in spite of his plans and his traps, he is able to protect and to guard me until I meet him on that day, on the great day of judgment. Because, ladies and gentlemen, judgment is coming, and it is coming sooner than later. Jesus Christ is coming back, and the Bible says, you will hear the trumpet being blown, and then the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords will descend with the hosts of heaven. Will you and I be ready? Are you confident of the future? Your confidence of the future should not be in the investments that you've made, in as much as they are good. I know some of us have great investments. You have this parcel of land, you have this money, even in offshore accounts, just in case Kenya rocks too much. Amen. In case there is a shaking in this country, yours is in international currency. You are not dealing with the money that we are now changing. You are on another level. Your confidence should not be in that. Your confidence should be that you will spend eternity with your Heavenly Father. That's the confidence I have. If I fall down right here now, I am sure that Jesus will receive me in his bosom. And he will tell me, welcome home, son. Welcome home, my child. Welcome home, my servant. I am 159.99% sure that that will happen. Amen. Look at your neighbor and ask them, are you confident of the future? You are asking them in a fearful way, and we are talking about being fearless. Ask them again, are you confident about your future? What did they tell you? Our surety, our security, our collateral comes in when we surrender our lives to Jesus. Because we have embraced the sufficiency of his grace. That is what gives us confidence for the future. It is what gives us confidence for the future. And Paul exhorts Timothy, and he tells him, guard the deposit. Take care of it. Guard the deposit which was given to you. Guard the foundation that you have in the fact of your grandmother who is a believer, your mother who is a believer, and myself as your spiritual mentor. Guard the gift of teaching. Guard the gift of preaching. Guard the church that has been entrusted to you. Be a good steward of what has been given to you. This is the deposit that has been given to you. Are you a good steward of the deposit that has been given to you? And he gives Timothy an example of two people, Phygellus and Hermogenes. And he talks about these people. Even their names sound bad. Their names are not even nice to the tongue. These people, Phygellus and Hermogenes, have deserted. They are those who are of the desertion ministry. Do you know you can have people of the desertion ministry? They tell you, we are with you. We are praying with you. We are standing with you. And they're only standing with you on WhatsApp when they send that message. After that, they are sitting. They do not even make a prayer. And they say, oh, pastor, we are praying with you. Do not be a Phygellus or a Hermogenes. Even the name sounds like jealous. Paul tells Timothy that in his ministry journey that there will be people of the desertion ministry. Even in your own walk of faith, There are people of the desertion ministry, the Phygellas and the Hermogenas, and they will pack their bags and go. But he also gives another good example of a gentleman known as Onesiphorus. And that name sounds like a chemical formula. Phosphorus. But actually, the name Onesiphorus means profitable. That was the meaning of that name. And I want to challenge us as parents, as we name our children, let's name them well, so that we are not calling them Phygellas and Hermogenas, and they keep deserting you. You keep teaching them the word of God, they keep running away from it. Why? Because of the name that you call them. Onesiphorus, his name means profitable. And you can see the way Paul speaks in verse 16 to 18. He says that this man refreshed me as a minister of the gospel. He lived up to his name. So as we name our children, let's name them carefully so that they can be of benefit to the kingdom of God. That they will be the Onesiphorus of our generation. Amen. They will be profitable to the kingdom of God. Do not be a quitter. Do not quit. Do not throw in the towel. Be fearless as a believer. Be firm for what you stand for. Even when it means that you will not get the bonus, stand firm. Be fearless as a believer. God has entrusted to you something, a gift, a calling, a talent. Take care of it. Guard it and leave footprints for those who come after you. Do not just live for yourself. Leave footprints in the sand of time. That the people who come after you, they will say, there was a believer. Pass on what has been entrusted unto you to the generation that is coming behind you. Pass the baton. And you know, as I finish, on a relay, when you are running a relay and you're carrying the baton like this, actually this looks like a very good baton, okay? If you're running on a relay with a baton like this, and I want to pass it on to the next person, as I get closer to where the person is, I don't slow down. I don't slow down. I even actually accelerate the move. And the person who is holding their hands at the back like this, to receive the baton, they start looking at my pace and they are watching me and they start pacing themselves with even a greater pace. And therefore, I am able to hand over the baton at a very high speed and it doesn't fall. If it falls in that relay, we are disqualified. So the problem with some of us is that we are running very fast. And we are about to hand over the baton to those that are coming after us. And those ones are running very slow. And then the baton falls. And there is no continuity of the gospel. I pray that as a church, that we would run in tandem. The young, the old, and the young at heart. We will run in tandem. And we will be able to pass on the baton. And we will be able to say, we have left good and faithful servants behind us that can be able to carry on the mantle of the gospel, that you will be able to pass it on to others. It will not die with us. It will not die with our generation. We will not keep saying the good old days. I am sick and tired of people who keep saying the good old days when there was a revival. Those are the good old days. Leave them alone. Why are you disturbing them? Talk about now. What are you doing now? Are you passing on the baton to those that are coming after you? And you need to do that in a fearless manner. And may the Lord help us to pass on the baton to the ones that are coming after us. We need to be fearless as we do this and I'm unapologetic about it. In Jesus' name. I want us to pray this morning. And as we pray this morning, I pray that we will be fearless in whichever sphere of life, in whichever capacity that God puts us in, that we will be fearless. Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, the name that is above every other name, we thank you for your faithfulness. We thank you that you've not given us a spirit of fear, but a spirit of power, a spirit of love, and a spirit of sound mind. And we pray if there is any form of fear in our lives, that it will be rebuked and it will be removed in the mighty name of Jesus. Help us to lead and to live a fearless life to the praise and to the glory of God the Father. Strengthen us in our walk of faith, that we will fearlessly hand over the baton of the gospel to the generation that is coming after us. We will hand it over to the young adults. We will hand it over to the teenagers. We will pass on the baton to the children. And that, Jehovah, you will be exalted as we walk in boldness, in courage, in stealth, and in strength to the glory of our Heavenly Father. As we step into this week, we step into this week boldly, and we pray that the grace and the boldness of God will overshadow and cover us to the praise and to the glory of God our Father. We give you praise this morning, and we honor you, for you are calling us to be fearless in matters for the kingdom. You are calling us to be fearless. Receive all the praise and receive all the glory. In Jesus' name we pray. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.